On Thursday, April 19th, 2012, I uploaded the first episode of Northwestern Railway Tales, NWR Tales for short, on this very channel. The story was Whistle Trouble, based on the 1985 annual story by Christopher Audrey. The software that I had back then was Trains 2009, Fraps, and Sony Vegas, all working on my old laptop along with its cheap little microphone. The video, as of April 2022, has since gained over 133,000 views and over 900 likes. Never did I think that this series would garner such a following and make it to its 10th anniversary celebration, but here we are. Over the years, my series has evolved, with a number of helpful script editors joining along for the ride, coming and going over time. Around 2016, I began making a timeline on my Divine Art page to broaden the scope of my series' history, as well as to tie in events from the Railway series books and the TV series. Over the years, many people have asked questions about why certain characters, particularly those from the TV series that weren't made by Audrey, appear in my series in decades like the 20s or 30s, despite them only being introduced from around the early 2000s. I began answering people's questions by informing them of the timeline of my series, but still over time more and more people kept asking such questions. From all this, I decided on doing one thing, to celebrate sharing 10 years of my series with you all. I decided to create a special series of timeline videos to explain in full to all of you, the fans, the lore of NWR Tales. As this is quite a long project, it has been split up into 10 parts, which will be released each month. It will feature moments that you all know of from the NWR Tales series, along with those created by Audrey and the various production teams of the television series, with the exception of seasons 13 through 16. So to kick off the 10th anniversary year, let's go back in time to the very beginning to see the progress of the island of Sodor and its railway history. Prior to the existence of the Skarloey Railway, the line between Crosnacurran and Battlewell began as a horse work line by the Crovensgate Mining Company in 1806. The pack horses hauled copper and wagons from the lower slopes of Wardfell and Crosnacurran to Battlewell for shipment. Between these points is a lonely inn called the Glenock, which was used as a staging point for the horses. By 1820, the mining company relayed the line with Fishbelly Edge Rail and had extended it up the Ben Glass Valley to the mine. It was simply called the Railroad. This was the only one of its kind at the time and was considered as a marvel in its day. In 1863, following the Festiniog Railway's lead, improvements were called for it to change the line to be steam-hauled. James Spooner was engaged to survey the line to see if such a thing was possible. It was initially intended that the line should remain a minerals-only line. The valley it served was sparsely populated, and it was thought that perhaps one coach in addition to a set of quarrymen coaches would suffice for local needs. In 1850, 13 years before the mining company had called for the idea of steam traction, another railway was being promoted called the Sodor and Mainland. The railway was projected to link Barrow and Furness on the mainland to the ancient capital of Sodor, Sudbury. The locals were enthusiastic, however the mainland had little interest in the service. Local investors were keen on the idea, with the railway promising those from Peel Godred a little branch line north from Cronk. The railway received an Act of Parliament in 1853, which included the proposal to build the Peel Godred line. Construction began in 1861 with a single track between Ballyhoo and Rolfe's Castle. Three off-the-peg Nielsen locomotives were purchased to help with the construction of the railway line from the Nielsen & Company's High Park Works in Glasgow, Scotland. One of these engines was named Neil, the number 2 engine of the Sodor and Mainland Railway, who is now preserved at the Railway Museum in Vicarstown. Sadly, we don't know the names of the other two engines, since the railway's attitude towards records can be described as having been casual at best, with most of their company recordings becoming lost over time. However, we are led to believe that the other engines were called Clive and Matthew. By 1865, the railway extended the line from Rolfe's Castle to the fishing port of Kirkronan, hoping to start a steamer service from Kirkronan to Dublin Island. The project ultimately failed, but a new narrow gauge railway had just opened up within the same year. During the survey of the railroad by James Spooner in 1863, the idea of the line being a minerals-only line had changed thanks to the accidental rediscovery of the long-forgotten lake and hidden hollow of Skarloey. In this period, spas were popular and offered the possibility of a lucrative passenger business, and the idea of developing Skarloey into a spa was conceived by Seamus Turbrock, the line would then be called the Skarloey Railway. A set of the most up-to-date coaches at the time were ordered from Brown, Marshall & Co. They will be named Agnes, Ruth, Lucy, Jemima and Beatrice. Two new locomotives were also ordered from Fletcher Jennings & Co. in Whitehaven, England, who were named Skarloey and Rhenias. They have been built alongside Tadaclin and Dolgoch of the Tadaclin Railway in Wales in 1864. In 1865, Skarloey was the first engine delivered to Kirkcudbright Harbour on the island of Sodor by steamship, which was run by the Sodor and Mainland Railway. S&M No. 2 Neil was there to deliver him to Crovinsgate. When Skarloey was delivered, he was, as described by the railway's manager at the time, Mr. Mack, a crosspatch on his first day. He was ordered to go to work dealing with the trucks as they came down the hill under the pull of gravity, as it was needed to pull them back up the line. But Skarloey wanted to pull coaches instead, and this placed him in a bad mood. He expressed his frustration by blowing smoke at the railway workers, believing they didn't understand steam engines. At last, the manager decided to have him covered up with a tarpaulin due to his sulking, a far cry from the old and wise Skarloey we're used to today. After learning his lesson, Skarloey helped out finishing the line with Mr. Bobby, who helped build him, Rhenias, Tadaclin and Dolgoch at Whitehaven. Later on, Rhenias arrived on the railway. He was sterner and more thoughtful than the young, bouncy and overexcited Skarloey. One day, Skarloey was set to take the directors on a train to show them the arrangements of the railway. All was going well, barring Agnes's complaining on the forward. And on the return journey, with the manager on Skarloey's footplate, things were continuing to go well, until Skarloey started to bounce. The manager, alarmed, closed the regulator too quickly, and Agnes's buffer clashed with the other coaches into Skarloey. Thinking that he was playing a trick on them, her and the other coaches surged against him, causing him to bounce even more, and making the manager lose his footing, causing him to fall off Skarloey's footplate. The manager was cross and called Skarloey a bucking bronco, and sat in Beatrice for the rest of the journey. The directors were badly shaken too, and told him to stay in the shed out of sight while Rhenias took the inspector around instead. However, the manager did apologize to Skarloey for being cross later that evening. After the inspector was pleased with Rhenias and provided the directors with direction on what improvements were needed to be made. He came to see Skarloey, and the directors explained what had happened the previous day. However, the inspector thought that the directors were mistaken on Skarloey's usefulness, and told them that what he needed was another pair of wheels. The cause of Skarloey's bumpiness was due to his short wheelbase and excessive overhang. So, taking the inspector's advice, Skarloey was given a cab and new training wheels. However, with the manager's words about cabs being the latest thing cheering him up, and the coaches calling him handsome and distinguished, Skarloey soon became too big for his wheels, and boasted about it to Rhenias. This caused a rift between the two of them, with Skarloey calling Rhenias a stick in the mud. Their feud was settled after Rhenias rescued Skarloey from a mudslide. With both engines laughing when they realized that Skarloey was the one who was actually a stick in the mud. All of these events can be found in Railway Series Book No. 20, Very Old Engines, by the Reverend W. Audrey. Mineral water was discovered around the Great Waterton area in a mine in 1866 by Mr. Samuel Waterton. Mr. Waterton had heard about the discovery of the Skarloey Spa, and knew that spas were popular with tourists. And so, with the rise of the railway, he had decided to build his own line heading to the springs. In 1867, the company was called the Great Waterton Railway. The line was to connect near the Ballyhoo Tunnel, with negotiations with the Sodor and Mainland taking place seeking running rights to Vicarstown and Barren Furnace once the tunnel and bridge had been built, though sadly that would never happen. In the meantime, the S&M had agreed to transfer passengers with wagonettes. The engine that would haul these trains to the station was an 060-well tank engine named Sunny, who came to the railway in 1868 to help construct the line. The line was opened in 1871, and from its humble beginnings as a station and a few houses for the staff at the spa, it then grew to become a town. Focusing back on the Sodor and Mainland Railway, the company had high hopes and big ambitions to connect the island of Sodor to the mainland. Of course, they wanted to generate excitement among the public by showcasing their dream with a proposed express engine that would take them there. Around the same time, a new locomotive was being built on the Great Northern Railway, the 422 Stirling single locomotive built by Patrick Stirling at Doncaster Works. The railway had requested to have one of the engines, and later that year, Emily arrived and was placed on display in a special shed for the public to see. However, the railway was soon faced many problems after this, starting off with the fact that the company was on the verge of bankruptcy, and the promise made to build the line to Peel Godred was becoming very doubtful, to the point that the people of the Peel Godred had concluded that they would need to build the line themselves. A line southward was favoured at first because it would be the simplest and cheapest option, but it would involve a junction at the S&M, and with their financial state at the time, most felt that the idea could be imprudent. 6 miles to the west, mine owners at Casna Harwood had combined with others across the Isle Valley to build a tramway to the port of Islesborough. The committee at Peel Godred approached them about their proposed line, and following a long series of meetings at Ulstead Castle with John Arnold Norrenby, the first Duke of Sodor, and with the mine company seeing the advantage in having a connection to Peel Godred, they came together to form the Mid-Sodor Railway Company in 1872. 2 years later, the tramway, which was relayed to Board of Trade Passenger Standard, was opened with 4 stations, which were Arsdale, Marthwaite, Farquhar Road, and Islesborough. A road coach was used to link Peel Godred and Marthwaite, while the mountain section was pending completion. Meanwhile, another railway was being built. Running along the coast between Crosby and Sudbury, with an intermediate station at Wellsworth, this would be the industrial line of the Wellsworth and Sudbury Railway. Some tank engines ran the line and had developed a considerable passenger clientele, along with servicing a number of unspecified lead and zinc mines. One of these engines that had worked on the line was called Lily, who was now preserved by the Railway Museum in Vicarstown. With the construction work done on the mountain road, the Mid-Sodor Railway was opened in October 1880. There was hope for a June opening following the inspection by the Board of Trade, but the inspector was disturbed by scanty clearances and refused to allow that, even though he could not fault anything else. It was pointed out by both Spooners, father and son, the latter of whom had surveyed the outlook of the line during the railway's construction, while his father was looking after the North Wales Narrow Gauge Railway, that the clearances to which the inspector had taken exception were, if anything, more generous than those which had been allowed to pass for the Festiniog. The inspector made a second visit to the railway in late September and reluctantly passed the inspection, with the condition that the safety precautions must be similarly enforced as on the Festiniog Railway, which included a requirement that all carriage doors must be locked between Arsdale and Ulstead Road. The opening train was hauled by MSR No. 1 Duke, who is now preserved at the Ulstead Castle Estate Railway. On the western side of Sodor, the first railway line there was called the Knapford and Elsbridge Light Railway, which was opened in 1885. The line was established when the Ulstead Mining Company were interested in minerals from the high ground southeast of Toyrek, using horses as transport. Due to the surrounding fenland prior to the railway's opening, the minerals could not be extracted and the section of the River Ells from Elsbridge to Knapford was a hazard. So, in 1883, the company had called on the A.W. Dry & Co., who undertook work on reclaiming tidal land from the sea. The company had built embankments across the flats north and south of the river with tidal gates installed. In addition, on the embankment on the south side of the river, the water was allowed to flow in a pool and be drained during low tide on its opposite side that was left undeveloped. The line began at a wharf in Elsbridge and curved east to mines at Toyrek, and from there, keeping to the firmest ground, swung round on top of the embankments in a Y curve, avoiding the remaining fenland to reach the harbour at Knapford. It was the Mid-Sodor's creative effort to build the Culdee Fell Mountain Railway to encourage tourism in the island and the Peel Godred district. The Mid-Sodor had hoped to extend their line around the head of the valley to Kirkmacken, where passengers could join a mountain railway for their ascent to the peak. However, with the engineering work ending up being incredibly expensive, the project was dropped. Lord Peter Borain was the landowner of where the mountain railway was laid, and his land would be directly affected by the scheme. He was reluctant to allow a railway to go through his land, viewing it as having a great possibility of disfiguring its natural beauty, although he was otherwise in favour of railways in general. Thus it was that for some years, the project hung fire. This ended up giving the Skarloey Railway an opportunity for tourism. They were in a position to provide easy access to a shorter route up in the mountain. The excursions were very popular. Wagonettes were met at Skarloey Station, and passengers would then be transported to the point where the ancient path crossed the Moorland Road. However, the popularity of these excursions left a depressing effect on the people of Peel Godred and Kirkmacken, as their tourist traffic began to dribble away. Their woeful complaints led to the deputation to Lord Peter with a request to change his mind. Thus, by February 1897, the first sod was cut by Lady Elaine, the eldest daughter of Lord Peter, to build the Culdee Fell Mountain Railway, sponsored by the Culdee Fell Tramroad and Hotel Company Limited, which had been formed by Lord Peter in 1896. He was therefore in the position to ensure that the lower section of the line would make a detour to skirt the edges of his property instead of cutting straight through it and up the hillside as originally proposed. During the previous year, the Snowdon Mountain Railway was opened in April, and they had given the advice of using the apt rack system, which the Culdee Fells soon adopted as their main gauge, thus almost making them twin railways like the Skarloey and the Tattyclin. However, the main difference between the two is that the Snowdon climbs short and sharp, 4¾ miles only, while the Culdee Fell is twice that length, with easy gradients at the foot steepening to a fierce 1 in 5 on the last half mile to Summit Station. Construction proceeded smoothly, and in March 1900, the line was approved by a passenger work by the Board of Trade after rigorous tests of both operational and safety measures. The test runs can be seen in Railway Series Book No. 19, Mountain Engines, by the Reverend W. Audrey, in the story Mountain Engine. The railway was opened on Whit Monday, and all went well for the first month. That was until an unfortunate accident happened with the Culdee Fell Locomotive No. 1 Godred. According to CFR No. 4 Culdee, Godred was the number one engine on the railway, and was named after Godred MacCarrald, who was the King of Sodor and Man from the year 979 to 989. Because of this honour, this made him all puffed up in the smoke box. He also lacked some common sense, and on a return journey from Devil's Back, Godred was derailed and rolled down the mountain. Thankfully, his passengers were safe and remained calm. Godred was recovered from the accident the next day, but was in such a state that his damage was beyond repair, and was left at the back of the shed at Kirkmacken. For years, Godred's parts were used as spares for the other engines, until eventually he became nothing. Because of the accident, the line was closed for the rest of the year so safety measures could be put in place to avoid ever having an accident like that happen again. It wouldn't be until Easter Monday 1901 when the railway would be opened again to the public. The story of Godred can also be found in the same book in the story Bad Lookout. However, the ending reads rather differently, as it was said that Culdee had made the story of Godred up. However, we can confirm that the accident really did happen. Most likely the liberty was taken so as not to upset younger readers. The cause of the accident has never been proven, but it was believed to have been caused by a stone lodged between two teeth of the rack rail. Despite Godred's sad demise, the other engines have continued to work on the line since its opening in 1900, including No. 2 Ernest, No. 3 Wilfred, No. 4 Culdee, and No. 5 Shane Duty. Prior to 1901, the Sodor and Mainland Railway's dream and ambition to connect to the mainland had been plummeting. At Ballyhoo Ridge, the tunnel had collapsed, blocking their way to Vicarstown and Barren Furness, and their attempt to erect a bridge across the Walney Channel fared no better either. Admiralty was obstructive about the proposed low-level bridge across the straits from the start, and when permission was finally obtained, the construction of the bridge encountered its own problems. First, the foundations were washed away by the tide. Then part of one span was lost when the cranes broke whilst hoisting it into position, and a strong gale also caused damage to the near-complete bridge. But the final nail in the coffin for the bridge was after a tragic accident in Scotland in 1879. At 7:16 p.m. on Sunday, December 28, 1879 at Dundee, Scotland, a violent storm had damaged the first Tay Railway Bridge. 46 bodies were recovered from the disaster. No one survived. However, the locomotive, North British Railway No. 244, was salvaged and then repaired and carried on working until 1919. At the time, 75 deaths were recorded through articles of the disaster. But according to members of the Tay Rail Bridge Disaster Memorial Trust in 2011, 132 years after the tragic accident, the true death count was about 59 people. The second Tay Bridge was opened in 1887 and is still standing today. Because of the disaster, plans on the bridge to the mainland were shelved, as well as the proposed express service with Emily. Due to these unfortunate events, the line only ran from Ballyhoo to Kirkronan, which were very likely ran by the Nielsen Box tank engines, until two of the three were sold off in order to raise funds to keep the S&M running. What we do know is that No. 2 Neil was sold to the Crovans Gate Mining Company to take slate from the transshipment siding at Crovans Gate to Kirkronan. The other Nielsen Box tank engine was sold to someone else, while one stayed with the S&M. Whenever the mining company found itself left without motor power due to required repairs for Neil, a haulage wagon from the Skarloey Railway was used to take the S&M's trains to Kirk Ronan, albeit at a very slow speed on standard gauge track. Because of its size, Skarloey was the only engine that could fit within it, as Rinias's wheelbase is longer compared to Skarloey's. As for the sole remaining S&M locomotive, it worked on to the end of its days, until eventually turned into scrap iron. With that, the mining company leased the line and added in a third rail from the mining company to the harbour at Kirk Ronan, with the haulage and transporter wagons left in storage until they were used again during the revival of the S&M under the NWR during World War I. But in 1901, the Sodor and Mainland Railway was officially bankrupt. Because of this, the wagonette trips came to a halt, and while the Great Waterton Railway tried to lure tourists back to its spars when it took over the wagonettes, tourists had flocked to the spars at the Skarloey Railway instead, which in turn caused them to become bankrupt as well, and the town and Sunny were soon abandoned. The S&M company still existed, but was dormant until 1914. Meanwhile, the Mid-Sodor had acquired a new engine from the Falcon Works at Loughborough, England. The engine's name was Falcon, named after the works he was built at, an 040ST tank engine, which caused him to bounce. He was shipped to Elsbridge Harbour, with his reason for coming to work on the railway sadly being to replace a locomotive that will be scrapped shortly after his arrival. Over in San Francisco in the United States, two little tank engines were built for the Bear Harbour Railroad. They were named Bash and Dash, and were based off their older sibling, Number One, or Gypsy as often nicknamed, who is preserved today by the Timber Heritage Association in Samoa, California. The Bear Harbour Railroad began its life in 1892, with Number One being delivered there from San Francisco. In 1893, only 2 miles of track was made, and by April 1895, the company had extended the Wharf 100 feet, or about 30 meters in the metric system. Around the same year, the railroad began to extend further inland until 1905 to Andersonia. Along the way in 1898, a second locomotive was built at Baldwin for the railroad. In Andersonia, a dam was built that held 20 million feet of logs and a mill that had a cutting capacity about 120,000 board feet per day. But sadly, during the same year, it was discovered that a certain framing had bad clearance for the railroad's logging carriage. Steps were taken to correct it, but a timber brace came loose and struck the back of Henry Neff Anderson's head, who was the chief partner of the Bear Harbour Lumber Company in 1903. Doctors rushed to him, but Anderson refused to go to San Francisco Hospital. He later died from his injuries on November 6. In March 1906, sawing had to be delayed as the company was waiting for additional machinery from San Francisco. Storms during the winter had damaged the wharf, and new timber had to hewn in the woods. But the final blow for the logging company came a month later, giving it the title of the million-dollar mill that never milled. San Francisco was shaken by a massive earthquake on April 18, 1906. It also ignited fires, which burnt the city for 3 days and destroyed 500 city blocks. The earthquake and fires had killed an estimated 3,000 people and left half of the city's 400,000 residents homeless. The railroad fell victim to the natural disasters as well, experiencing numerous landslides along the line, causing several hundred dollars of damage to the line and the mill. Around that time, Bash and Dash had been completed and were thankfully safe from the harm of the earthquake, but with the railroad out of commission, they had nowhere else to go and were facing the scrapyard. Thankfully, a logging company at Killdane on Sodor were in need of two locomotives themselves, and so they were sold and then shipped off to the island of Sodor to start their new life once fears of the earthquake's after effects had passed. Meanwhile, the other standard gauge railways around Sodor were still going. For the Knapford and Elsbridge Railway, the harbour at Knapford proved to be a disappointment to them, as it needed constant dredging, and by 1905, the cost had become prohibitive. A.W. Dry had recommended to the Ulstead Mining Company to abandon the harbour in favour of extending the line to Tidmouth. Horses, though, were not deemed appropriate for the long haulage of the lead mineral trains, and A.W. Dry had tasked a young engineer to build light locomotives in their place, which were the coffee pot locomotives. The engineer, of course, was Topham Hatt. 4 of these locomotives were built for the railway at Tidmouth, and one of them remains in preservation, which is, of course, Glynn, who is now preserved at the Estate Railway at Alstead Castle. A replica version was built by the Railway Museum at Vicarstown in around 2016. This replica was originally called Glyn at first, but was later renamed Topham in tribute to his designer, and to avoid confusion with the one at Alstead, once it became known that the original had avoided being scrapped, as had been initially assumed of its fate. Progress with the extension was going well until autumn 1908, when the coastal part of the line was damaged by a severe storm. The disruption led to unemployment across the mining company, but with A.W. Dry having personal and financial ties to the mining company's operations, they helped to arrange a loan from the Treasury to put the miners back to work by cutting a tunnel directly to Tidmouth, which was overseen by Topham Hatt, and the first steam train ran through in July 1910. As a result, the company was renamed to now be called the Tidmouth, Knapford and Elsbridge Light Railway. 2 years later, in 1912, the railway then merged with the Wellsworth and Sudbury Railway, and then formed into the Tidmouth, Wellsworth and Sudbury Railway, with Mr. Topham Hatt keeping his position as engineer. The Sodor and Mainland, the Wellsworth and Sudbury, and the Tidmouth, Knapford and Elsbridge had all merged as one in 1914, sponsored by the government, to become the North Western Railway, with Mr. Topham Hatt rising to general manager of the railway. This is where we will end our first of 10 chapters in this timeline. In part 2, we will cover the rest of 1914 and then continue on from 1915 to 1939. Thank you.